Please give them a round of applause. That is the wishes. We're going to start with prayers. Unfortunately, Reverend Winston is not here yet. We're waiting for him, but we're not going to wait any further. So at this point, we're going to ask Reverend Pastor Ayoti from Ohio to please come and say a prayer for us. And after that, we're going to call the Mistress of Ceremony to start your patient. Thank you so much.
Reverend Engineer Ayo from Indonesia, Associate Minister down by this church day in Ohio, November 30, 1870. That's when we started this church day in Ohio. I'm glad to be here tonight, so let us pray. Oh Lord, our Father, we thank you for this day that we never knew that we were going to see. But through your grace and mercy, you have allowed us to see this day. And as we come together as to celebrate this program, Lord, which is for the children. We thank you for allowing us to be here one more time. We thank you for the traveling mercies for people that have traveled from far and wide to be here. We thank you for Mrs. King, who continues to still do what she has to do, your will, for you to give us strength, give us good health. So we come at this time, Lord, to cherish our children. Because the Bible says in Proverbs 22:6, train up the child the right way to God when they grow, they won't depart from it. So we're here, Lord, doing your will, taking care of our children. We pray that all this program here will be to benefit all these children and let them know that we are watching so that they can be the men and the women that God wants them to be. Be with us through this program and give us family mercy back to our different destination. Cover us with the blood of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Monica Coffin Pearson, and I am very happy to be your MC for the evening. Again, we'll thank the Soweto Street Beat for the dynamic procession and the Zulu tribute and celebration of this occasion. That was fabulous. I will say this much for Mrs. King. We had a hard time from keeping her joining in the dancing. On behalf of the board of the A.D. King Foundation, welcome to the Gala Award Ceremony. We invite you to enjoy us tonight as we pay tribute to so many pioneers, unsung heroes, youth honorees, and humanitarians who have made innumerable and significant contributions to the community and lives of others. Tonight would not be possible without our sponsors, right?
Yes.
And our dedicated sponsors, I'd like to pay recognition to them now, and please hold your applause until all have been introduced. I would ask you, as I introduce you, to please stand so everyone can see you, so that later on, they can come up and thank you personally. I have Mr. Ronald Blue Trust, that company. And you will be speaking later, Mr. Crossan. We have Dr. Adede G. Adeleke, the Joe Beasley Foundation. How about, come on. We've got Judy Forte, Dr. Alveda King. Then we've got State Farm, Alani Ogilade. I know Alani's here. No? Carol Chisanga, CARES Foundation. Thank you, and her beautiful Nigerian lace. Reverend Stephan Ferguson, Mr. Nicholas Stone Street, Kimmy Construction Company, MTI Limo and Shuttle, Trinity Dialysis Clinic and Project Second Chance. Please let's give all of our sponsors a warm round of applause. Prayed and then blessed the food, but now we need to pay tribute to our heritage and our country. Please follow the program and stand for the national anthem and remain standing for the Black National Anthem. If you want to take the knee, that's all right with me, but I won't be able to get back up. Okay? The words are located on page 23 in your program. Please stand for the honor guard. We're so happy to have these young people with us tonight. And so you will know, they are the Ebenezer Baptist Church Scout Honor Guard.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars rule a perilous fight? For the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the
forever in the path we pray.
Scout Honor Guard. Just an observation. We all knew the first verse of the national anthem, but all of us over 50 knew all the verses of the Black national anthem. And my editorial comment for the evening, I think it would make a great period national anthem. So thank you for singing it, thank you for standing for it, thank you for showing your patriotism for voting. So now I'm going to welcome back the president and CEO of the ADP Foundation. You all know him as Dr. Baz, but he does have a last name, Onabanjo. Following Dr. Baz, we'll take a view of a video presentation that explains to you the work of the A.D. King Foundation. Dr. Baz.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Monica Kirsten. She's so lovely, isn't she? Yes, I'm going to have a time. Thank you so much. Welcome and thank you for joining us for this evening of fellowship and leadership as we celebrate the lives and contributions of our pioneers, unsung heroes, youth and humanitarians from our communities. Before I continue, I would like to take a moment again to thank our sponsors. Without them, none of us would be here this evening and enjoying this special occasion. Let us give them a round of applause. Again, we are in this space to celebrate the contributions of our heroes and to commemorate the 86th birthday of Dr. Honorable Mrs. Naomi King. Please give her a round of applause. For those of you who do not know her, she's the sister-in-law of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Mrs. Coretta Scott King, and Dr. Christine King Farris. I would also like to recognize my wife for 31 years.
All right.
Thank you very much. My darling, and I better mention her name before I forget. We salute our international recipients, Dr. Roberto Ben Aguayo, in this flight, but we'll be here tomorrow. For the entrepreneurial spirit and leadership award. Mrs. Juanita Albanati, I know she's just watching. Please give her a round of applause. Mrs. Alicia Boom, I know she's here. Dr. Doris Darby, where is she? Civil rights movement on some heroes. Ms. Simpson, is she here on some heroes? Ms. Kain Gue, is she here on some heroes? And Ms. Carol C. Chief Sanga, is she here? Yes, she is here. Ms. Jonian and the Youth Empowerment and Spanish Leadership Award recipients are Tia McCauley, and Michelle Gatson, where is she? We are extremely proud as we continue in the quest to pass the baton to the next generation. Through the youth empowerment programs, nonviolent strategies as a way of life, partnership with law enforcement and community policing, health summit, entrepreneurship models and practices. These are various programs that we implement at the ADP Foundation. I would like to acknowledge the presence of our dignitaries that have come from far and near, and our elected officials. Also, our board of directors, please rise if you're here. Board of directors. Elected officials. Any elected officials here present? Thank you. I'd like to give a special thanks to Ronald Blue Cross, our title sponsor. Please give our mistress of ceremony, the renowned Atlanta television broadcast journalist, Mrs. Monica Pearson, and our husband, Mr. Pearson, a round of applause. Power of the media. We use the power of the media to change the narrative. We must use the power of the media to change the narrative of the state of Georgia public private school, where over 100,000 students drop out of school each year. What a waste of human capital. We're going back to a different kind of slavery in form of legalized printing, the industrial complex in the 21st century. A time has come when silence is seen as a betrayal of conscience and responsibility. Let us rise and change the narrative of developing new winning strategies of excellence, compassion, innovation, and creativity that will empower our youth, ensure academic excellence, and eradicate poverty, despair, and hopelessness. Let us build a new, vibrant society of love, hope, compassion, innovation, creativity, and entrepreneurial spirit and productivity. In 1997, when the Southern Christian Leadership Conference was formed by some of our incredible pastors, which include Reverend Lincoln, the motto was to save the soul of America, not keep, not white kids, not black kids, not poor kids, not rich kids, but the soul of America, which includes our children. We are called to speak for all failing youth in our school systems, regardless of status, creed, color, gender, national origin, especially the poor, the hopeless, who are part of our collective society and humanity. We are living in a country with a profound set of problems. In my humble opinion, in 1972, there were approximately 370 people in jail. Today, there are 2.2 million. The United States of America has the highest rate of incarceration in the world. Furthermore, we have over 6 million people in probation or parole. There are 17 million people with criminal records, which makes securing a job or getting a loan nearly impossible. The ability to survive becomes a difficult task. The victims become economically handicapped, socially undesirable, and mentally disabled. Hope is lost. Despair becomes real. Rational behavior becomes non-existent. Please picture this narrative in our minds and imagine its significant impact on our communities, and of course, from the children of God. What country are we living in? What has this country become? The percentage of women in prison with minor children has increased by 600%. Wow. 70% of these women are single parents, which means that when they go to prison, their children get displaced. Statistics reveal that half of the prison population suffer from mental illness. These poor mentally disabled souls are being set up by a massive system of incarceration. The Bureau of Statistics predicts that one out of three black kids born in the United States will go to prison or jail during his or a lifetime. Please come to your neighbor and say, how do we stop or resolve this systemic and endemic problem? Would you do that for me, please? Ask your neighbor, how do we stop this endemic problem? We know it is not right. It is unjust and ungodly. God help us all. With you, God, to be potent and to be present and everlasting and over, through which all things are possible. This scenario was not true in the 19th century or in the 20th century, but it is true and real during our own watch, our own time. I would like to remind us that freedom is never won permanently. It must be sustained by every generation. There are four things that we must do to change this narrative. One is what I call proximity. Proximity to the issues, get closer to the topics and where these issues exist. Where are bad schools? Where do drugs come from? Who uses them? Where do most crimes occur? What are the nature of these crimes committed? How can we help? We are often told to stay away from these places, but remember that Christ did not come for the righteousness, but for the sinners. We need to get closer to where these issues are. Where there is neglect, where there is despair, by getting closer, we discover the innate power that we have. You have more power to change the world than you ever feel realize. When you get proximate, you see that you have the power that will manifest. Do what God commanded you to do. Clothe the naked, feed the poor, visit those in prison, and do good. Proximity is power. We cannot change the world without changing the narrative of what defines the power which sustains the problem that we see and we feel. We must identify drugs and dependency as health issues, not issues of crime. Our world is health issue. So is drug addiction. We send millions to jail who don't belong there, creating a culture that has been driven by a policy of fear, mandatory sentencing for drug abusers. Yet, nothing is being done about alcohol addiction. We must change this narrative. Some children don't matter, that's what we say. We are not free. We are a post-genocide society. We have to change the narrative of race, not white supremacy, not black domination. God only created one race, and that is human race. Let us change this narrative. Slavery did not end in 1865. I think it just evolved. It turned into decades of terror, nation injustice, and economic servitude. We should have been subjected to truth and reconciliation, just like South Africa and Germany. We have to change this narrative. We have to be hopeful. Hope is what is essential to change. Injustice prevails when hope doesn't exist. Hopelessness is the beginning of justice. Hope will motivate you to speak when people say be quiet. Hope will get you to stand up when others ask you to sit down. And hope empowers. Hope is essential to create justice. We have to be able to do uncomfortable things. Keep beating the drum for justice. That was a man with decades of imaginable proportion when it comes to civil rights movement. I want to talk about that man just for a few minutes. And at the end of it, I will identify who this man was. This man did not sit down, he turned the world upside down. In 1964, when the first, in 1965, there are two laws were passed, which actually changed the fiber of American society. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965. This Voting Rights Act of 1964 was as a result of the demonstration in Birmingham, Alabama. They used to call it Birmingham then. And the Civil Rights, the Voting Rights Act of 1965 was as a result of similar demonstrations. And then the last is the ordinance that was passed in Louisville, Kentucky, where African Americans or anyone can back home where they choose if they can afford it. These three laws changed the fiber of America. And this gentleman that we're celebrating today, with his wife being here today, to honor and become witness, name was Reverend Alfred Daniel King. So Reverend Daniel King was not just a brother to Dr. King, he was an icon of the civil rights movement. So don't look only at how we treat the rich. Look at how we treat the poor and the incarcerated. In this room, we have the capacity and the energy to change the world. Thank you, Dr. Ruth Parker King, for making a difference each and every day. What a great sacrifice, and to God be the glory. God bless us all, and God bless the United States.
He went to jail unarmed with his brother.
He couldn't go into public facilities, so they started using the churches. They started having mass meetings at the churches.
And a lot of people saw Martin Luther King Jr., but they didn't see Andy Reed King, who was really some of the other inspiration that I saw that Dr. King had, because they were close.
A.D. was almost as good a preacher as Martin.
A lot of us would watch him preach, and he was one of the preachers I said, all right, put down here. We would try to pick up turns from him in his ministry.
I don't think that his objective was to get out from a lot of people know him, where to speak for him.
She was the one that really instituted and led that open house demonstration and marches to bring about the open armaments in Louisville, Kentucky, under the leadership of A.D. King, Leo Lesser, and Reverend Kirby in Louisville today. The church that he pastored in Louisville, Kentucky is not a monument. And a lot of people go there basically because that's the church that A.D. pastored.
Begins running through the house, get out, it's a bum, my brother's here. He comes on down the hallway. My brother's in one room, my sister in another room. We run out this door back here, which is the door going out to the garage. And we get out of the house, and they had to come back in and get my baby sister. And then we run out through the garage, and on out and over the fence.
I was in the living room. Looking at television when I heard the first blast. And I was standing in my door when the second blast went off. And the king was in the yard. He called, "Somebody help me." And a man came down the alley and went over there to help him.
When I looked around, A.D. and Naomi and them were jumping the fence to get out on the side. And
we were helping them out of fits.
And by the time we walked to the middle of my home and we looked back, this is the picture that was seen from a second bomb. There were two bombs, a second bomb, and this is what was left of my beautiful home.
I was one of the student leaders. We had been doing the demonstrations in Birmingham when it came down. I was one of the groups with the security folk who went over to the house to sort of stand guard. But it was really too late because the bombing had taken place.
After Martin Luther King Jr. was shot and killed, I remember my husband went into a deep state of mourning.
I think A.D. really never quite got over his brother's death.
You see, he never been so hurt as when his brother got assassinated.
And then shortly after that, his mother was killed while she was playing the Lord's Prayer.
Couldn't get over that. And he was traveling there night and day.
The tragedy of the family is just overwhelming. A.D.'s death was both a tragedy and a mystery. He died drowned in his swimming pool in his own backyard, even though he was a good swimmer.
Some say he was murdered, some say he was slain.
And there's never been a clear understanding of what happened.
I must catch up with them, I am their leader.
He's a bad man. Fear death. He's a tough
accommodations would never have occurred if he had not been in the forefront. So thank you again, as a Kentucky girl who grew up in Smokedown, thank you for your contribution. So we know it's her birthday that we're celebrating tonight, but none of this evening would have been possible if it had not been for Naomi Barber King. She's going to come up and give a few remarks and will be followed by Dr. Alvina King, her daughter, with her brief reflections on her father. Please stand to welcome Naomi Barber King.
And every one of you. Thank you. Lord, for my blessings. Take a hand next to you, squeeze it in unity, in the spirit of my beloved husband, the Reverend A.D. Whitman King. Let us pray. This is the day you have made, Lord. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, if we had 10,000 hands, we would praise you with every one of them. Yes, we would, Lord. I ask for special blessing on each and every one of you who are here tonight. And I hope that you will do God's will in your everyday walk in life. And I declare unto you, if you will do this, he will give you the desires of your heart. Lord, I love you, magnify your name. In your spirit, we all say, amen.
Amen.
My name is Naomi Ruth Barber King. I am the sister-in-law to Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr., Coretta Scott King, Dr. Mrs. Christine King Farris. It is with much pleasure and delight that I welcome each and every one of you to this 8th A.D. King Foundation Youth Empowerment Awards Gala. I sincerely appreciate your taking the time to come out this evening to share in this occasion, which I hold so very dear to my heart. This evening, we are honoring those who have contributed to the A.D. King Foundation's commitment to empowering youth through enrichment programs, mentoring, nonviolent strategies as a way of life, the creation of healthy lifestyles, and embracing entrepreneurship as the engine of economic growth and development. We recognize the contribution of women in the civil rights movement, and today we are honoring the Atlanta matriarch and social change activists of civil rights movement for their brave work in the struggle for justice and equality for all. We salute our international recipients, Dr. Onabanjo, Equality, Onabanjo, Entrepreneurship, Spirit, and Leadership, Mrs. Juanita Abernathy, Ms. Alethea Davidoon, Dr. Doris Durbin, Matriarchs of the Civil Rights Movement, and unsung sheroes everywhere. Ms. Simpson, unsung hero, Ms. Kim Guy, unsung hero, Ms. Carol C. Shianga, humanitarian, and our Youth Empowerment Aspiring Leadership Award recipient, Ms. Tia McCauley, and Ms. Daisha Gasson. Lastly, we are honoring my late great husband, Reverend A.D. Williams King, brother to the dreamer, who himself dreamed of a society of nonviolence and peace, and he bravely lived and died for that cause. As A.D. King Foundation continues my beloved husband's legacy for civil and human rights, we strive to pass on this legacy to the youth to empower them to continue in the quest for positive social change. I am delighted that we have with us Dr. Ronald McDowell, who has been commissioned to create a life-size bronze statue to be placed at the Birmingham home that AJ and I shared during some of the years of the civil rights movement. Dr. Ronald. Delighted to have in attendance many dignitaries, leaders, families, and civil rights leaders, supporters, and friends to share in this occasion. My heartfelt thanks to all of you. May God continue to bless and keep all of us during these trying times. I will definitely continue to stand and pray for peace and nonviolent principles, women and youth empowerment and entrepreneurship as the engine of economic growth throughout the world, alongside with our title sponsor, Ronald Blue Trust and others. Thank you for listening. May God bless us all.
Hello, everyone. Isn't that mother just amazing? Can you give her a round of applause? I'm Dr. Beth Onabanjo. This is Onabanjo, mama, our family, Earthly, is my sister that helps take care of mother, but the board of directors and everyone here. Monica, who is here? We lost the three of you. Dr. Jesse Taylor, I'm so glad to see that this one has been mentioned there. So it's so good to be here with all of you. And Celeste is my oldest daughter. And then Aneta is married to my wonderful son, Jared. You all be standing next to each other. Wait a minute. And Eddie and LaShondra will be wed in February. Grandsons, so there are 10 grandchildren and 6 living children out on my side. I asked them all to come up. I did want to mention, honestly, Dr. Onabanjo has done such a beautiful job. We met each other right here on this campus and many years ago, around 1983 or 84. And he would look and he'd talk about my dad, and I'd have the pictures, and I would show him some of the things that Dad brought back from Africa when he visited Africa. I had some of those in my office because I was holding on to some of Dad's cherished memories. I showed him a picture of my dad in a dashiki with a big medallion and Mama in her dashiki, and they had the big afros and all of that. And we would get to just talk about all the commonalities of people, whether you were born on the continent of Africa or here. And the more Dr. Bass heard about my dad, and he began to say, but nobody knows your dad. Why doesn't someone know your dad? And he began to be very close to my mother, and she would share so many memories with him. And through the years, he's worked very hard with the A.D. King Foundation for youth empowerment, women empowerment, to work for nonviolence and all of that. And I believe if Daddy were here tonight, his heart would just be overjoyed. And I thank him for the media that he has done, the film and all of that. And all of these pictures, Babs, Dr. Babs and others have been able to collect over the years. So you have a beautiful souvenir booklet here. And I encourage you to keep it. Look at those photos and keep that, and you'll see much of the work that my dad did. Two or three things that people don't know about Daddy. He was one of the main strategists of the civil rights movement. And he had a lot of business acumen, along with his spirituality and his ability as a freedom fighter. And so he could go into those corporate boardrooms with the Caucasian people and the Jewish people and say to them, this movement is right and it must be financed. Dad can get them to give their jets, because we couldn't fly commercial and get on those planes easily. And they would fly the members of the movement around the world and the country. So Daddy was able to do that. Some of the main strategies you see, he was often in the background. where he decided that that was a good place to be because Moses had Aaron.
Yes.
President John Kennedy had Bobby.
Yes.
And Martin had Betty.
Yes.
So that was one of my memories. Daddy telling us about all the trips and the journeys and the fighting. He did honestly stand on the car in Birmingham, Alabama, the night after they bombed our home, when we all came out safely. And Daddy stood on that car and he says, listen, don't fight, don't turn over those cars, don't be violent, don't riot. If you have to hit somebody, hit me, but I'd rather you go home and pray. I and my family are fine. I remember Daddy standing there that night. That's one of the things I remember. I remember him walking me down the aisle as a young bride, and then a week later, he of course was not drowned. There was no water. Okay, so he was not drowned. But that was the story that was told. However, he and his brother were like that all the way through their lives. And Daddy missed out on the mail to Daddy though. And I still miss Daddy, believe it or not. I really do. I believe if Dad was here tonight, he would be okay with me asking you to put one hand over your heart and raise one hand towards heaven. And I'm going to sing a song that I learned, blessing and a prayer. Because we're coming up on dinner in a little while. And so it's a blessing. So if you close your eyes and let me bless you with this song. Bless this house, O Lord, we pray. Make it safe by night and day. Bless these walls so firm and stout, keeping want and trouble out. Bless the roof and chimneys tall. Let your peace lie over all. Bless us, Lord, that one day we O Lord, with thee. Amen. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand clap. Thank you.
Let's talk about another round of applause for us. Those are very warm and wonderful reflections and a welcome. Now, we're very excited about our next presentation and an announcement from the Ronald Wood Trust. At this time, I would like to introduce to you and welcome to the podium Nicholas Stone Street. He is the Chief Executive Officer of Ronald Wood Trust, and he will introduce to you tonight Mr. Russ Crossan. Let's give a round of applause so that there are many sponsors.
Ms. King, to serve on your foundation, your husband's foundation, and it's such an honor to serve you and to be a part of this, truly. Dr. Babs, such a great friend, such a godly man. Ronald Wood Trust is an organization that is a financial services organization. We give unapologetically Christian biblical counsel about money. And we work with many wealthy people all over the United States and have about $9 billion in assets now in the firm, and it's continuing to grow, and God continues to bless us. I want to tell you a couple of things. One is, there's books out here. This book is called The Truth About Money Lies. And there are a lot of lies out there about money. And I've given a lecture several times in Morehouse and other schools where I talk about the man. And it's basically the man is green. Because nobody really cares what color you are if they can take your money. And so I think it's really amazing tonight that we have Russ Crossan with us. Russ is a founder of Ronald Wood Trust. He started it 37 years ago after going to some very impoverished places in the world. And God really put on his heart to start a firm that would tell the truth about money. And his specialty, he's just an amazing man. His specialty is counseling rich people not to be greedy. Because we know what the scriptures say. If you're greedy, you'll end up falling under the same condemnation as the devil. So that's a bad place to be. So I want you to hear from Russ a little bit about the truth about money lies. And he's going to talk with you through a few of those truths and a few of those lies. and you're meeting a man who's dedicated his life to helping Christians free up their hearts to be more generous and give away more so that they can bless others. Russ Bronson.
This won't be that long. So basically, we don't have a choice. We neither believe the truth of God's word about money, and there's over 2,000 verses about money. We can buy the lies from the world. Okay, and we have chosen to start a company, like Nick said, that's going to apply biblical principles to people's finances. We love being a sponsor of this A.P. King Foundation because you guys are about empowering youth. And I think one of the ways that youth are empowered is that they don't fall into the lies that the world tells them about money. Okay? The Bible says, instruct those who are rich not to be conceited or fix their hope in the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy, instruct them to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous, ready to share. So you and I have a choice. We need to be rich in good works and generous and ready to share. And I'm going to give you two four-letter words. That's a wise person. A wise person is generous and ready to share and rich in good works. Now the option, or the opposite of a wise person, is the rich farmer over in Luke 12. What did he do? When he had wealth, he was not generous and rich in good works. He just built bigger barns and stored it up, and he was called a what? A fool. So men and women, we all have a choice with our money. We need to be generous, which is wise, or we can try to hoard it up, and we'll be called foolish. And see, we all have a choice. We can either accept or reject the truth of God's word, or we're never free from the consequences if we decide to reject it. And unfortunately, many people are rejecting the simple teaching of the Bible about things like debt, about being generous, about diversifying investments and things like that, because they bought the lie of the world. And for the sake of time, I'm just going to give you one thing to think about, because I know Bab's going to come up here in a few minutes and ask for some donations. Let me just talk about one of the things, one of the lies we fought. The lie is that somehow our wealth is a measure of our self-worth. And so we're about building bigger houses and buying more stuff and accumulating more things because we think that's what makes us worth something. But the Bible says you and I are worth an incredible amount because of who we are in Christ and for His workmanship. So we're worth an incredible amount whether or not we have money or not. But unfortunately, we get out of balance and we begin to build all this stuff up because we think that's what makes us worth something. That's a lie that we believe. That's not the truth. And to make matters worse, that's what we do. We use money we don't have to buy things we don't need to impress people we don't even know or like. Think about that. And that's how we get in debt. And debt is one of the greatest things that will keep young people from being empowered and free to make an impact on the world, which is what this foundation is about. So I would just encourage you to have a healthy fear of debt. The only reason we get in debt is because we bought this lie that the stuff I have, the more things I can, the trappings of wealth, are what may be worth something. That's not true. And here's the thing. If you decide that it's about building wealth, you will always only impact a limited sphere of people. Let me illustrate what I mean by that. How many of you have ever been to Kansas on vacation? Anybody? Yeah. Does anybody go? Okay. Well, I grew up on a farm in Kansas, all right? And Julie and I, my lovely bride over here, we have three boys. And so when the kids were young, we put them in the car, we leave Atlanta, we head back to Kansas to see the grandparents. We had a tradition in our family that when we were going back to Kansas, we'd get off the interstate and drive on the two-lane roads. You know, the ones, you know, where you go through all the little towns and you go into the local cafes and they say, you aren't from around here, are you? You know, that, so you know, they know you weren't. But here's what happened. We're driving on those little two-lane roads. We couldn't do that east of Mississippi. You had to wait until you got west. And back here on the East Coast, the roads don't go anywhere. They just like go all around. But when you get on the other side of Mississippi, they kind of go straight. So we'd be on these two-lane roads. We start driving, and what would happen is we'd come up to these little towns, and up on the hill was a guy that had decided his work was tied to his money. He had the big house, you know, had the nice cars, had the fence around, all the cattle out front. He was the guy that had a lot of financial wealth. And then you go on into town, the houses get smaller and smaller. You go across the railroad tracks and a bunch of double-wide trailers. You got the visual? You ever done that? Been driving on two-lane roads? Maybe in South Georgia or whatever. So here's what happens. What happens 40 miles down the road? 40 miles down the road, the same thing happens. Big house, smaller houses, railroad tracks. And then it dawned on me, the guy in the one town doesn't even know what the other guy has. And that's when I realized that men and women, if you make it your goal to build wealth, you will always and only impact a limited sphere of people. But if you use your wealth and you invest in things like the AB Foundation, and you do things that empower young people, you'll impact an unlimited sphere of people. See the difference? You can either build up stuff here and impress a few people that know what you have, what you drive, where you live, or you can invest in youth empowerment, invest in what's going on to make the world a better place, and impact an unlimited sphere of people. So remember I said you can be wise or a fool. Let me just leave you with this comment that Jim Elliot said, that great missionary. He is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. So I would hope that you would continue to be generous, continue to help empower these youth, because that's the truth about what's really going to matter. Don't buy the lie of the world. So thank you for allowing us to be a sponsor and be here tonight. Thank you very much.
Books are out. Sounds a little bit like a difficult process of what? Tithing. Thank you again, Mr. Crossman, for being here tonight. We are now going to have a musical selection from Sinfonia. They are quite special looking over there. As they play, we are going to start serving dinner. We're going to start with the table with, of course, Mrs. King, and also the guests over here. Follow the lovely lady in the blue so that you can get your dinner. Now, let me go back to telling you about Sinfonia. The Youth Orchestra, they're named in honor of William Grant Still, the Dean of Black Composers. Still Waters Youth Sinfonia of Metropolitan Atlanta celebrates over 25 years of instructing thousands of young, talented instrumental and dance students, as well as providing over 400 performances locally, nationally, and internationally. Sinfonia is under the artistic direction of David E. Robinson III. Mr. Robinson, please stand. Mr. Robinson is a fifth-generation, 33-year string teacher of the DeKalb County School System. You don't look much older than 33. Sinfonia performs various types of music, most of which are arranged by David. Still Waters symbolizes the works of the world's greatest black composers. These composers are underrepresented and usually under-recognized, as in buried treasure beneath the sea of waters in a distant ocean. A sinfonia is a short symphonic work for a small orchestra that intimately offers a variety of music to be enjoyed by any audience. Therefore, Still Waters Youth Sinfonia is a tribute to Sinfonia, is a tribute to rare works by black composers such as William Grant Still. So as you make your way to get your dinner, keep your ears open and your lips sealed so that we can enjoy our young audience. Again, do not go to the tables until you see this lovely young lady in the black and blue skirt.
the table has shrimp in it. Thank you.
Mr. Earth and Sims Humphrey. These performances will be followed by a presentation from Mrs. Zika, Pauline Zulo-Ventra, who will introduce our evening keynote speakers. So for right now, you can chew, but not so much chatting, so that we can enjoy our music for the evening. Mr. Ellerby, it's time for you.
The key is having faith. But the key is you have to know exactly what you're having faith in. So y'all with me real quick. When I shout out hallelujah, can y'all shout out hallelujah with me? I know you're mouthful, but when I shout out hallelujah with me. Okay. I'm shouting out hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Don't you know that's the highest praise? Lord, I want to get up. They called the shepherd boy. But then the prophet spoke three things. See, man sees not how God sees. Therefore, I am a blind man, Lord, help my eyes, please. If I had one wish, I would wish to be a wise man, comprehension everywhere my eyes land. I thank the Spirit because he guided me. But sometimes I fall deaf because the devil be like, just hold the cash and let your flesh write a check that your soul can't cash. Lord, I thank you for this insight. Yes, Lord, because I was headed down the path looking dark and then my skin tight. See, Satan thing was supposed to fail. He had me thinking I was right on my road to hell. But I'm thankful that I see the light. Ain't nothing worse than the wrong person that's convinced in Christ. See, every day I learn that day's lesson. And you think I'm just resting, but I'm not right now. I'm in my faith section. Hallelujah! Thank you, hallelujah! Let me want to say it with more emphasis than because whatever is your will, I want to be in that alignment. My flesh telling me to line up, but I ask you for my mission. You said still, build my body up. Raise it up as what his word say. So I try my best to do it like you did it on the third day. I'm not a preacher, but I like to reach up and reach them. Let them know the knowledge and prestige still. I'm not worthy. Is there another hand? He said, Lord, if you didn't know Moses was a stuttering man, that lets you know that I got you. But the part that you fail to prevail is this not you. I get it now, Lord, to choose me. And like the song say, I give myself away so you can use me. But that means I gotta lose me and obey what you say, even if they refuse me. What you mean, Lord, my enemies? For what they've done is unforgivable to see the thought of them. Love them as I have loved you. get hollowed in that name and bring the story ever told. All right, so this is what I'm going to do, y'all. I know we eating, so we about to jam the rock. I was going to do some chords, but I need to get some music going on here. Y'all ready? All right, so this is what I'm going to do. I got the DJ. You know, when I was going to church,
if you feel it in your feet, then stomp. And if you feel it in your legs, then jump. And if you feel it in your arms, then wave on. If you feel it in your hands, then praise on. Y'all ready?
Yeah.
All right, let's go. Turn up, DJ.
Pray. Is go to my porch and stand my floor. Danielson said, if this is the price for me learning karate, I'm gonna stand your floor. So Danielson went to second floor. And what I learned is, guess what? A lot of times when we can just learn the lesson, trust the process, and go through it. I just appreciate you guys for coming out, tuning in. It's a blessed event. I'm home for God. Thank you so much. Have a good night.
Excellent job. I really thought he was good. Mr. Ellerby? It's tough when people are trying to eat. Because we were just a little bit late starting, so everybody's tummy was starting to growl. So as soon as they said time to eat, we all ran. And Mr. Ellerby had a hard but excellent job of performing. And he held our attention enough that we know that his hat and his shirt match very well. He is full of faith. And we are definitely in Faithville, thanks to you, Mr. Ellerby. Now, you know, we tapped our feet. The problem is there's carpet in this room. So you couldn't hear us stomping. Even though we couldn't, you know, jump up and down, we were patting our feet. So I like your rap. That's one you need to do more often. Very good. And I think the young people like it. So that's one way of teaching faith in a way that they can dance and sing to. So do we now have your music, Mr. Scott? Are you ready to give us your melodious tones? Now I just need your attention one more time as Mr. Scott comes to perform for you.
I will see you face to face. Thank you so much.
Good evening. I know that you all are eating and partaking of the food that has been prepared, and I hope you're enjoying it. And I am Roberta Abdul Salam. Thank you. I am a member of the board of directors for the A.D. King Foundation. And some of you may know me from being state representative in the House of Representatives for many, many years. But my job at this moment is very important. Many of you know my story. I started activism when I was 13 years old. And it was because of organizations like the A.D. King Youth Foundation that helped me grow and go around the world doing good works. And it does not stop. So what I need each of you to do this evening is to help some other young people that are in that path, or on that path, and you don't know where they may end up, soaring all the way to the top, but they need your help. We have envelopes on the tables. We're asking you to dig and donate generously. Sister Elvita King talked about her memories of her father, and it was such a blessing to hear. Mrs. Naomi never stops. She never stops because she's dedicated to these young people. Won't you help us help them and help these wonderful young people, those in the room and many more that aren't in the room, to continue the work and the legacy of Reverend A.D. King, of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., of Ms. Naomi Ruth Barber King, and all of the sheroes and heroes that went before. Make a donation this evening to the A.D. King Foundation. Please do so, and do it knowing that God will reward you in your giving. Thank you all so very much.
I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like, oh,
sometimes I
a round of applause again for our performers, Mr. Larry Helleby, Mr. Robert Scott, and Ms. Eartha Sims Humphrey. And now a very special presentation. Mrs. Sita Pauline-Zulo-Banjo will introduce our evening keynote speakers. And I want you to be ready for a very special treat, because they're the young folks, and they're the ones who are going to take care of our future. Ladies and gentlemen, Mrs. Onabanjo.
Good evening. You guys don't sound like you are happy to be here. Good evening.
Good evening.
Are you happy to be here?
Yes.
I'm going to talk about something that is very dear to my heart, and raise up your hand if you know somebody who has high blood pressure. Okay, high blood pressure has become one of the most preventable diseases that we have, and it is very preventable. The only thing you cannot change is who you are, where you come from. It doesn't matter. What you have to do is what you eat and how to take care of yourself, exercising. I'm going to read you an inspiration that was published by this magazine. This inspiration I wrote it when I met a 30-year-old whose husband died of high blood pressure. We think that high blood pressure is an old person's disease. Now high blood pressure affects our 20-year-old. And high blood pressure is a silent killer. So what you guys need to do is make sure you go to your doctor or you go to CVS. Something as simple as going to Walmart and measure your blood pressure. Sometimes you have blood pressure for years without knowing it. Other people are fortunate that they can find that they have high blood pressure. But some people, they come to the hospital, I make it ready, they come in and they are dead because of high blood pressure. So I'm going to read you this inspiration, the sting of death, fighting high blood pressure. Hey, Kirby silhouette, casting a shadow on the wall. She's oblivious to all these things around her, standing in the midst of her living room. Her thoughts a million miles away. She did not realize that her shadow created a picture on the wall. The light accentuated her reflection, making her bigger than life. All these people in her home are mourning, groaning, and crying in pain. She's oblivious to their pain, for the sting of death has pierced her already torn heart. She wears a black veil to conceal her sorrow. What will happen to her? What will heal her wounded heart? What will cover the stabbing, piercing pain that is inflicted deep down into the core of her heart? Who will help her? In her belly, she feels that pain that is already consuming her from inside out. She loved him through and through, in and out, to the deepest of his soul. But she could not keep him safe from this thing we call death. Death was too strong for her to fight this grief. It was stronger than her. She pulled away and put herself in the abyss. She was beginning to explore this mystery, this deep love for her. She did not need much convincing. She had deeply fallen in love with him. The moment their eyes locked, she knew he was going to be her husband. He knew he was going to be the father of her unborn children. He was her deep, calm ocean, her still waters that went deeper than any other ocean. She had never known. She was safe in him, safe in his heart. She trusted him. with the most prized possession. Her heart belonged to her, to him. Like the piano chords, they knew each other's rhythm and would play the same tune. When death knocked and came down, he did not bring an artist. Like a midnight prowler, coming to steal, death snatched him away from her loving arms. She did not have time to say the appropriate farewell. Is there appropriate farewell in death? I think not. Her feet heavy, with legs cemented. She could not move. Her mind wandered into that intimate space she shared with her husband. She never thought of herself beautiful. She was a full-figured woman, blessed with the curves, which she never fully appreciated. She was mesmerized when this attractive, wonderful man requested her hand in marriage. Every time, she could not fathom in her mind why this god of a man would ever ask her for her hand in marriage. Her husband said, "Baby, I love you. You are my everything, my heart from eternity to the earth, to the moon and back. You are my life partner. We will grow old together. You are the mother of my unborn children." Her mind drifted back to her broken heart. She's a grieving widow at 30. Who knew that the midnight prowler would snatch her husband so young? She did not have any children. These are the own children that she always wanted to have with her husband. That dream was never going to be the same, never going to be realized. She placed her cold icy hand on her belly, her womb forever barren, never knowing the value of her joy. She closed her eyes and began to weep as she saw her unborn baby in her dream. The baby was looking down from heaven with those beautiful eyes that looked at her husband. She had met her daughter before in her husband's face. She knew her husband would meet their unborn child because that unborn child remained in heaven. She embraced her baby tightly. She knew she had two guardian angels to watch over her. She was sad because her blood pressure had taken her soulmate. And the doctors had told her, "Do you know that high blood pressure is the number one killer, especially of African American men?" She bowed her head and said, "No, sir, I didn't know. But from now on, I'm going to educate my people. I'm going to educate my brothers. I'm going to educate my brothers and sisters and the husbands that I know of so long ago." She whispered, "Dad, with your bitter skin, you will never win. Let's all fight out that pressure because we have the knowledge to do so. Thank you." And now coming to something nice, I'm sorry that I have to say that, but it is very important to me that we know about our health. So now I'm going to introduce two beautiful youth that I've ever met. Dasha Gladstone. Dasha Gladstone was born in Manhattan, New York. And she can trace her heritage all the way back to the Caribbean. Dasha was a host at the English discussion at the Library for USA Visa Applicants in Africa, volunteered to the US Embassy in Conakry, Guinea, working with the ministries. Dasha holds an associate degree in science from Atlanta Metropolitan College and she's working on her bachelor's at Creighton State. Then she devoted herself to her family, learning and working towards the manifestation of her own company. Goodness, yes, strength. Without any further ado, Ms. Dasha Gibson.
All right. It gives me immense pleasure to stand here before you as a keynote speaker of the 8th Annual A.D. King Foundation. Gala, I'm sorry, as a youth honor. I would like to start by thanking God for a second chance at life and this experience. Dr. Babb and Ms. King, this would not be possible without the two of you. Thank you for choosing me and molding me. I began volunteering in 2009 for the Each One, Beach One program at the Birmingham Community College. There I helped my mentees with tutoring, my job interviews, resume building, stress management, and I just listened to the things that they were comfortable with sharing with me. I was the perfect fit because I shared most of the same struggles and hardships. My mantra was, you must sacrifice the old you and demand respect for the new you, or they will always treat you and look at you the same. Most of us are still in contact today. I grew up in the largest project in the country, Long Island City, Queensbridge. It is there that I learned to be a server. I always had a helping spirit, although I always questioned my faith growing up as the Reverend Marnie Oates' grandmother. I had a religious conscience that haunted me and heavily influenced my everyday etiquette. While I attended BMCC, I was inducted into Phi Theta Kappa. After several hardships and life-taking course, I obtained my associates here May of 2017, and currently I am attending Clinton State University, where I aspire to obtain my bachelor's degree in nursing. At the Metropolitan State College, I met Dr. Babb Onabanjo, who instantly became my mentor, and shortly after he introduced me to Mrs. King and Coach K, Mr. Kevin McDermott, founder of A Second Chance. As a GED recipient, I vowed the magnitude of A Second Chance. Our relationships are so surreal, and even though they have families and obligations of their own, they always make the time to commit and contribute to the community. I realize that no matter how rich, popular, beautiful, tech-savvy you are or are not, there is always a way that you can help someone else. Mrs. King, I am so ashamed that I did not know who you are and I was not aware of your story sooner. However, timing is everything, and I have just acquired $60,000 in medical bills. I survived a hit from an accident, and I won't share all the injuries and things of that nature, but you survived a hate crime. You buried some of your babies, as well as your soulmate, and you are so pleasant and happy. You taught me to appreciate life and focus on the positive. And the only worries that I should have are my hairstyle, a good pair of shoes, as your mom told you, a woman should always be prim and tidy, and a nice pair of shoes, and ways that I can help others. Thank you. I love you and I appreciate you so much. As a youth in leadership in our community, you must show intelligence, motivation, and an analytical aptitude for uplifting others. I realize that volunteering could be as simple as giving a compliment. Can anyone share a definition of volunteering? Anybody? Thank you. Yes. Amazing. Once I participated at the A.D. King Foundation Business Schools with Dr. Babs and Mrs. King and Coach K engaging the youth. I learned so much from the kids, and seeing Mrs. King taking her time to hug and kiss all the kids softened my heart. Some of those boys and girls may not have received any affection in a long time. I remember going with Mrs. King and assisting her as she spoke at a summit empowering women from all over the world. I was honored to see sisters connect, especially Africans and African Americans. I also participated in Happy in Atlanta. I remember a guy asking why we were there, cursing. I could feel his anger, and I was not afraid as others shied away from him. He refused our water, and the sandwiches packed by a local church that was there as well. My son, who was 3 at the time, walked up to him and gestured for him to take the bottle, and would not take no for an answer. He teared up as he accepted the water and calmed down. It was that moment that I realized that love is what we need. And it is stronger than any fear, money, power, and respect. It is imperative to have a reputable work ethic, and I continuously work on mine. I was not born with it, but I literally forced myself to be consistent while maintaining a persistent nature. Although it is heartbreaking to see other human beings suffer while I'm suffering myself, I felt that it's crucial to always know what's going on, engage in help. In my view, the characteristics of an unsung hero are all but not inclusive to my interpretation. First, she must come from humble beginnings and be very patient. She is selfless, ambitious, and defines her own version of beautiful. She is hardworking, not perfect, and always keeps a smile and an optimistic frame of mind. I say that to say that a lot of people become successful, and it's easy to share that part, but we also naturally choose to skip most of our hardships. So I think it's important to share the bad as well as the good, because those are things that are more relatable. It's hard to relate to the attorney when we don't know about eating noodles for several semesters and, you know, struggling to pay rent and things of that nature. I won't talk too much, but to all our unsung heroes and civil rights activists and just everyone here tonight, thank you all. You all are amazing, and let's connect and continue to, you know, grow this amazing legacy.
Without further ado, Ms. Tia Mahali.
Two at the front table. Anyone else in the room? Over here at Mrs. Abernathy's table. And then also in the back, we have two, and then over here. And then the gentleman here, do you need an envelope, sir? Do we have an extra envelope?
Yes, ma'am.
Could we please take the envelope to this very handsome gentleman here? The gorgeous streak of gray hair. Can you do that for me, young man? Please? Well, let's have the young lady then do it. To the gentleman right there sitting next to the lovely lady in the yellow with the shawl on, the beautiful pink shawl. Keep going. There you go. Any other contributions anyone would like to make? Do you need an envelope? We also need an envelope over here, one of our awardees tonight. Do you mind, madam, taking another envelope from a table and taking it to Dr. Derby, please? Well, thank you. We need one more. Over here, she needs an envelope. Symphonia, are you all going to perform now?
Vision.
Oh, Vision is next. Okay. So when are they performing again?
Four women.
All right, four. No, I've got four women. Okay. It's a good thing we're family. We can raise questions as we go. You're on hold right now. So now it's time to have a selection by Vision Dance entitled
four women, and you'll recognize one of the four. Let's hear it for them.
Four older women.
With a couple of guys. And here's our award winner, who is going to explain to you. You just need the mic. You're going to tell me what we're going to do.
I like to give props. Props to the single mom at home feeling discouraged. Just know that you're a one. Let's give props to that young lady that's feeling emotionally and physically drained because she's been tossed around like a retail. Let's give props that still continues to be unbothered. We live in a world where we are belittled, when we have the strength to fight because we are strong and we are the foundational strength of the nation. The more we fight, the more we see our destiny in a different light. And with this light, we will no longer feel belittled. And the most beautiful thing is we will see our worth. We will pledge to ourselves, I pledge allegiance to my sisterhood of strength, who have felt the effects of deprivation and belittling. And to the sisterhood we stand strong, one family, under love and justice for all.
We are helpers. We are lovers. We are fighters. You know, we love strong. We are also human. You know, that means we're vulnerable. You know, we hurt. You know, we ache like everybody else. We need somebody to be strong for us when we are taking the bumps, the bruises. We're here on the front lines fighting so many battles that many people are not privy to. You know, we are sisters. We are aunts. You know, we are deaconesses. We are leaders in our churches. You know, we are speakers. We are writers. You know, we are CEO boards and advocates. We need our brothers to stand up and defend Black womanhood. Don't silence us. You know, be happy that we're here. We're here to enable you, to empower you. But we also need that empowerment to go both ways.
Is on chosen people, a royal prince, that you were called out of all the time.
of the A.G. King Foundation, because it's now time to present our awards. All right. And may I ask a favor, those of you who did stay, to please take some photographs and you tweet everything else. How about let's tweet, Instagram, and Facebook our winners tonight, so that those people who were not able to come will know what a wonderful evening we had. Don't you agree? So now that we're up here, I'm going to start introducing our winners. The first two we've already met. Ms. McCauley is a high school student and an aspiring businesswoman. One of her passions is dance, as we just saw. And public speaking is definitely one of her strong points. Congratulations, Tia McCauley. Tia. And Tia, we want you to stand, boy, you change fast. And then I'll get out of the way so we get a nice picture with the entire board of directors and the award winner. Why don't you all scoot over, and I'll scoot out. You've already met. She's a student at Clayton State University. She's a passionate humanitarian, very self-determined. She works as a volunteer. She's going to finish her education so she can continue to make a difference in the lives of others. Miss Deja Gadsden. Just like Hallmark, when you care enough to send the very best, you send Dr. Valerie Young, who will receive the award for her. Thank you, Dr. Young. Thank you.
Up next, Dr. Doris Derby. She began her journey in her hometown of Bangor, Maine. However, she has traveled the world, and along the way, she has empowered the lives of many as an educator, filmmaker, anthropologist, photojournalist, and a civil rights worker in deep South Mississippi. The former director of Georgia State University's Office of African American Studies, her leadership made the difference in setting standards, modeling programs, and leaving a legacy with the university unsurpassed to this day. Congratulations, Dr. Doris Derby. You are
a pillar in the international business community,
Dr. Tune Agbeo has ingenuity that has won him many awards and recognition locally and internationally in Nigeria, the United Kingdom, and of course here in the USA. His network of partners and influence span across many countries, Germany, South Korea, China, and of course many African countries. Tupe's greatest assets are to spot opportunities where no other person is looking. He possesses the capabilities to discover and to create wealth where other business leaders have given up or have fallen short. Often called a genius, Tupe has the tenacity to address and confront difficult challenges, constantly displaying wit and resolve to address the situation. A proven leader and motivator, Tupe is known to possess distinctive leadership skills and always leading from the front, motivating his team of seasoned professionals to deliver complex solutions timely and professionally. Accepting the International Award for Dr. Agbeo's belief of behalf is Miss Abby. Miss Abby? Oh, Abby! Thank you, Miss Abby. You have worn lots of hats tonight. Okay, now November 17th was actually your birthday. I know that, but we are going to celebrate tonight. So don't anybody move on the board of directors, because we need you to stand here with her and Mrs. Abernathy. And Mrs. Abernathy, we need you too, because we're going to celebrate a birthday. Thank you.
shop, ladies and gentlemen. Please don't forget to go see our vendors. And Dr. Babs, as usual, we're going to let you have the last word. Come on up. And as you go out, our wonderful symphony will play for us.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Before I have the last word, I just want my colleague to just say one more thing. I just want to appreciate you for coming tonight. It's been a wonderful night. We spent a long night together, and I think it's been so beautiful. I'd like to thank our sponsors for such a day like this, because without them, this would not have been possible. We pray that God Almighty will continue to protect you. You will get home by God's grace and all is well. Thank you. We'll see you once again next year. It's been a wonderful night. Thank you. Please give Miss Monica Pearson a round of applause for such a wonderful job. Thank you. Thank you. And to all the recipients, thank you so much for coming, and we really love you. God bless. Please stay behind and let us clean up, please.